Welcome back. You're still on Urban Today with me, Deedon, and the beautiful, beautiful, talented Amaru. And yes, she's just been telling us about a bit of her history when she left Uganda, went to Kenya, and then moved to New York. Now, she actually auditioned, if I get that right, she auditioned for Juliet. Now, Juliet, in her words, I know it only from the movies how big it is, but in her words, it's as big as Harvard or Oxford University, but this time specifically for the arts. That's music, drama, and all of that. So how did you find out about Juliet and then decide to audition?
Okay, so my mom always said, if you're gonna do something, go big.
I love your parents.
Pushed us for like
mom and dad, can we move in with them? Yeah, okay, yeah.
Exactly. So when I thought, okay, I'm gonna be an actor, I thought, why not just, you know, from the movies? So I also saw Juilliard in the movies, and I thought, yeah, what about Juilliard? I'd never left Africa at that point. I'd never been outside of the continent. So I thought, if I was going to go anywhere, because for acting school, you have to apply.
Yeah.
You have to apply, and then you have to audition.
Wow.
So you travel
so
for the
step
audition.
One is
step one
apply,
is apply.
And then
and you get the invite for the audition.
So they invited
and then you. Travel.
You.
Mm-hmm.
What did you, how did
when
you,
travel.
When you send your application, what are they looking for?
So, okay, actually, so for Juilliard, everyone has to audition. You have to physically travel. And because I was in Kenya, nobody auditions in Kenya, so you have to travel all the way to like Europe or somewhere.
Yes.
Or in New York. So I traveled to New York for the first time.
Yes.
And I fell in love with the city.
What?
Yeah.
Are
so
you
I auditioned.
Serious? Yes.
I auditioned. And there's a three-stage process.
Yes.
So like multiple people audition over a series of a couple of days.
I can imagine. And these guys in the States have been practicing from the time they were born in
exactly.
the womb.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And then they're shortlisted. So then you're shortlisted at the end of that day. And then you come back for a second audition, which if you qualify for, you're narrowed down to 40 people.
Yes.
And out of the 40 people, they pick eight students. They pick eight or 40. I can't remember. But basically out of like hundreds of thousands.
Yes, I can imagine.
Yes. So I made it to the second callback. I was shortlisted.
Wow.
And that's where my dream died, in the sense of I didn't
get it. What do you mean your
it.
Dream? Well, at least you took the first two steps.
I did.
So you actually, you can put that on your CV.
Yeah,
I almost made it.
I almost auditioned.
They know me. What did you do after that, now that you didn't make it to Juilliard?
After that, I think a lesson from this is I tried again. I applied to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts.
Okay, so the next
the oldest,
best thing.
Yeah, the next best thing. It's the oldest actors conservatory in the English-speaking world.
Yes.
And I got into that one.
Amazing.
So I traveled. My parents were amazing. They flew me back to New York.
Yes.
Another trip. I auditioned. I got in. Studied.
Wow.
And I think it's through acting that I got confidence to pursue music.
You know what? It's so amazing. What I'm hearing is they told you no, but you still tried again, which most of us never really do. We always quit. So when you joined this American Academy of Dramatic Arts,
yeah,
is that when you discovered your musical side of you? Because your voice is, I swear to God, you must have been singing since you were three.
Thank you.
Yeah, your voice is powerful. It's beautiful.
Thank you.
So when did you decide, now guys, let me bring in music?
So it's actually after I graduated acting school and I was working a marketing job selling lint rollers in the tri-state
area. So your parents paid for drama school and then you decided to do marketing. What's wrong with you? Most of us, our parents pay for marketing business school and then we do TV. We go the other direction, not what you did.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay, so they hired actors. There's a twist. They hired actors to do live infomercials.
Yes, okay.
So you traveled... You know, you traveled to malls basically, and you did like you were a salesperson but an actor, and
like,
you had a script that was rehearsed.
Okay.
And you made people feel like they couldn't live without this product.
Yes.
So it was like a glorified salesperson.
It was a glorified
salesperson.
Yes.
So I'm just going to call it what it was.
Yeah.
And I was doing that, and I realized that's not what I wanted to do. So I quit after a few months, and I got a paycheck for the next 2 weeks, and I went into studio, and that's how I recorded Stay.
Talking about Stay, you went to studio. You're still in the States.
Yeah, in the States.
Mm. Now, we're going to talk about the cost implications and all of that. But when you were thinking about Stay, what pushed you? Because you've just quit this job, you've gotten your paycheck. Most people will be like, now, should I go back home? Should I go back to school? You decided, no, I'm going to stay. Is that why the song came out called Stay?
No, I was in love, Deedon. I was in love.
Girl, dude, hold up. Let me even put some of this in my coffee. You are in love.
I was in love.
So that's what inspired Stay.
Stay was inspired by love.
And that's why you stayed in America?
No, I came back.
No, but you stayed for quite a minute. This is yes. True.
No, but.
But stay was but inspired by
was,
love.
Yes, it was you inspired were deeply by love. In love. I yes. was in love. I was in love and I was starting to write songs and I was working this stupid job I was really hating.
Yeah.
And I was frustrated and so I started to write. I think like the music came out in frustration, frustration and longing.
Yes.
And like, yeah, so. That's how
amazing,
I wrote it.
Amazing, amazing. Because most of you, I don't know if you got to watch the video, but we'll be showing you a couple of her music videos of the some of the things that pieces of arts that she's done. Now, when you were in America, you decided to write Upstay. What was the cost implication for you? Because as I know here in Uganda, it is not easy to actually, it's very hard for most of our artists to pay for studio time, mm-hmm. and then go ahead and do a video. Uh-huh. But now I'm imagining you're in New York. New York is not cheap. Mm-hmm. It's not a cheap place to stay at. Mm-hmm. How did you manage to do studio and still survive?
I saved. I cut my costs. I ate $1 pizzas, pizza slices if you had to.
Yes.
Also, I went to a studio that was an hourly rate because most studios are like that. So it yeah. was, I think it was $35 an hour.
Yes.
And I recorded Stay in 8 hours. Because I had to, you know, when like your wallet is saying you can't go beyond this time.
Yeah.
So it was 2 studio sessions, and so you rehearsed as much. I rehearsed as much as I did. I had the song came to studio with guitar, and she's like, yes. boom, 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 boom. Yes. Got to like finish
and you're
the thing.
Done. Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about your music career, especially now that you're back home mm-hmm. in Uganda. I'm gonna be very real with you. East Africa, your style of music is not yet fully blown. I remember when Maurice Kiria started his style of music, he was not making money, but he kept on doing it. How was it for you when you came back and you're pursuing, how should I call your music? I call it neo-soul, but since it's Africa, should I call it neo-afro-soul? I don't know how to call it.
Uh-huh.
How did you pursue it? Because most radio stations and most TV stations were not pushing that. They were pushing the music that was coming from the likes of Baby Cool, Radio and Weasel, the Chameleons, the Kapukas, the Tanzanian Bongo Flavor, the Kenyan... you know, Ogopa DJ kind of thing. That fast beat, dance, dance. How did you manage to infiltrate, or how was your journey infiltrating into the music scenery right here in Uganda?
In Uganda?
Yeah.
So I think when I released Stay, I was still living in New York at the time.
Yes.
And I was coming home occasionally just for short breaks.
Okay.
And during that season when I came back, I walked to a couple radio stations
yes.
with a CD and the flash drive, hey, yes. can you play my song? And there's a lot of like, what do you have for me? Like, is there something for the producer?
This,
and I was like, no.
So you were
so
already...
I went through that.
You went through that whole process
that
of
process.
Being told, no, we don't play your music.
Yeah, we don't play your music. Yeah.
Let me tell you.
I did. It's a real thing. People
it's
go through
hassle.
It and I went through it. I totally
it's
went through it.
It's a real hassle. Basically,
yeah.
Ugandan market does not care whether you went to America or not. We don't want to play your music, we'll play your music, apparently.
Yeah.
But that is her journey. What we're going to do is dive more into her current music status right here in Uganda. We're still talking to Amara, but we shall be doing that a little bit more when we do come back after this break.
By the screen.